going to do is talk about places within Amazon where we are applying machine learning technology. And before I jump into the details of my talk, I just want to show a video. So recently we launched a product called Amazon Echo. And how many people here know about Amazon Echo? Okay, almost everybody. But and this is a great example of the kinds of applications that machine learning is enabling right now, and the kind of applications we're going to see in the future. Amazon Echo uses machine learning extensively within the product. Okay, so let's just get this thing up. Hopefully this works.
When I first arrived from Amazon, I didn't know what it was. What is it?
You'll see.
Is it for me?
It's for everyone. It's called Amazon Echo.
How's it going?
I'm just finishing up right now.
Is it on?
Oh, it's always on.
Can it hear me right now?
Nope. It only hears you when you use the wake word we chose. Alexa.
Well, what does it do?
Alexa, what do you do?
I can play music, answer questions, get the news and weather, create to-do lists, and much more.
Awesome. Huh. Alexa, play rock music.
Rock music.
Alexa, stop.
Wait, I'm gonna try.
Alexa, what time is it?
The time is 3:27.
You actually don't have to yell at it, okay? It uses far-field technology, so it can hear you from anywhere in the room.
So it can just hear you anywhere?
Yes. Well, everyone can hear you anyway.
Oh. Is that where I'm gonna put it?
I was thinking of putting it there, but it works anywhere.
Echo's pretty neat because it knows all sorts of things. All you have to do is ask.
Alexa, how tall is Mount Everest?
Mount Everest's height is 29,029 feet, 8,848 meters.
How can it know so much? It's so small.
It updates using the cloud. That's also how it gets its answers.
Just read that off the box, Tom.
Dad really likes that Echo just plugs in, so we never have to charge it. Plus, Echo's really good at keeping track of things like shopping and to-do lists.
Okay, but Alexa, add wrapping paper to the shopping list.
I've put wrapping paper on your shopping list.
Alexa, how many teaspoons are in a tablespoon?
1 tablespoon equals 3 teaspoons.
Okay. Alexa, set a timer for 8 minutes.
8 minutes, starting now.
Dad's not a morning person, but Echo definitely helps him wake up.
Alexa, alarm off.
You gotta get up.
It's Saturday.
Alexa, what day is it?
So, maybe I'll just stop the video here. You kind of get the idea. And, so Alexa is one of our applications which uses machine learning very heavily for voice recognition, for, let's see. This up, voice recognition, understanding customer intent, answering questions, and a whole slew of name entity recognition, and a whole slew of other tasks. So here's just an outline of my talk. I'll start off by providing an overview of machine learning concepts so that we're all on the same page, and then I'll talk a little bit about applications of machine learning at Amazon. Besides, Alexa is clearly one of our more recent applications, but we've been doing machine learning for 20 odd years for product recommendations and so on. So I'll talk about some of the applications and the challenges that you have in some of those applications. Clearly, people use platforms and tools to develop applications. So one of the things that we're working on extensively within Amazon Web Services is providing developers great tools so that they can quickly develop applications. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the pain points with the platforms and tools that are available right now, and what we're doing to solve some of those problems. And finally, I just want to end my talk with talking about some of the big AI challenges out there, and many of them we're working on at Amazon, some within my team here in Bangalore. Okay, so real quick, what is machine learning? So what machine learning systems do is they discover hidden patterns within data, And then they use those patterns to make predictions about future data. So an example of a pattern is if a product title contains the words jeans or a jacket, then the product very likely belongs to the apparel category. So what machine learning systems do is that they learn from examples. And this is very much like how children learn a new language or learn to recognize objects. For example, a five-year-old really doesn't know rules of grammar, but they're still able to speak grammatically correct sentences. They're able to speak a language, right? And so how have they learned all this? They've learned it from examples. They've heard adults around them speak. They've heard, you know, watched programs on the TV, watched movies, and so on. And that's where they've got their speaking ability. And they're able to speak primarily learning from examples without really knowing the rules of grammar and so on. And so machine learning works very similarly. Okay. So why do you need to learn, right? Why not just write a program? There are many tasks out there, speech recognition, handwriting recognition. Humans are very good at them, but they're not really amenable to algorithmic or rule-based solutions, right? You can't write a program that easily to recognize a horse in an image or to recognize any of these digits, right? So machine learning approaches that are based on pattern recognition are a lot more effective at such tasks, right? So there are many tasks out there where machine learning is the right way to do, is a much easier way to do things than trying to write a program to solve the task. And of course, you know, when these tasks need to be performed repeatedly at scale, humans are no longer a viable option, and automation using machine learning is the only option. And in many cases, the patterns that you're looking for are really embedded in large amounts of data. And also the number of patterns may be extremely large. For example, in personalization applications, we're actually looking to learn patterns for each individual user, right? And in such cases, you really need machine learning, okay? You know, there are many types of machine learning methods out there. In supervised learning, you know, the training examples that you have are labeled, right? And supervised learning has approaches typically have two phases. You have a training phase and a prediction phase. In the training phase, you know, you're given all these training examples, which are pairs of features, which are the XIs and your targets that are YIs. And what your learning algorithm essentially does is it learns a model F, which is nothing but a function that best fits the training data. So you're trying to make YI very close to FXI. So your learning algorithm essentially is an optimization algorithm that's trying to find a function F that is going to make the YIs and FIs, FXIs extremely close. And then in the prediction phase, you have a new sample X and your Y is unknown and you're trying to predict Y using FX, right? So in this case here, you have a website, a web page, and that has many features. So examples of features could be the text in the web page, it could be the URL of the web page, and so on. And your model F here takes all those features and then predicts whether the web page belongs to an e-commerce site or not. Okay. So that's the prediction part. So we saw one application, which was Alexa. But really, there are numerous applications of machine learning all throughout Amazon's different business verticals. In the retail side of the business, we're using machine learning to forecast the future demand of products. And these demand forecasts need to be extremely accurate, because if you forecast the demand to be very high, you're going to end up with excess inventory that needs to be stored. So that costs money. You need warehouse space to store all this inventory, extra inventory that you've ordered. And if you really forecast the demand to be extremely low, then you're going to the product is going to go out of stock. And you know, that's not going to be a very good customer experience. You're not going to be very happy if you go to an Amazon product detail page and then find that the product that you're interested in is not available. So clearly, I mean, we want to get these forecasts to be quite accurate. We're using machine learning to predict the lowest competitor price for our product. And that again enables us to provide our customers with extremely low prices. And you know, there's a lot of behavioral data Amazon collects because of people's browsing patterns and so on. So for instance, if within the same session you looked at a pair of products many times, and we found that a product pair was browsed by users in a number of different sessions, then it's very likely those two products are substitutes, right? Because in the same session, users are looking at both the products. So we analyze a lot of these behavioral signals that we get from customer co-purchases of products and co-views of products to try and infer relationships like accessories, complements, substitutes, and so on. And if we are out of stock on a product, we can suggest a product substitute to the user. In general, our customers are going to be very happy if we recommend, if we show them low-priced substitutes for a product that they're looking to purchase. Amazon has been a pioneer in the area of product recommendations. We came up with collaborative filtering algorithms way back in the mid-1990s. I'm sure most of you have gone to the Amazon, visited our Amazon product page and seen our widget there, which is customers who bought this also bought. And these are essentially computed, based on data mining algorithms that look at, frequent product co-purchases and so on. We have over 50% of the market share for product search queries, and we are using machine learning there for ranking search results and also extracting making sure that we show our users the most relevant search results. We have a very fast-growing advertising business where we are, again, using machine learning techniques to predict ad click and conversion probabilities. So that's our product ads business, which is now actually called sponsored products. And, of course, we do customer targeting. We have models to compute the propensity that a customer may purchase a certain product, and then we use these propensity scores for targeting customers with specific products that they are most likely to purchase. We have a large marketplace business with over 2 million sellers, and here again we recommend products to sellers so that they can grow their businesses and revenues on Amazon. We send alerts to the sellers if they're likely to go out of inventory. So if they're likely to go out of stock on a product, we remind the sellers that it's time for them to replenish the product. We also send alerts to sellers if they've priced their products too high relative to the market. Coming to our catalog, we have over a billion products in our catalog. So this is the largest selection of products that you're going to find on the planet. And there are many challenges out there. One is around classifying these hundreds of millions of products into our product taxonomy. We have these large product taxonomies with over 20,000 leaf nodes. And typically the way customers discover products on Amazon is either through search, so they type in search keywords, or they browse through the product taxonomy, right? So you start off at the root and then you work your way down. And I have some examples there, and I'll talk about that a little bit more in my talk. The reviews that we have are a huge asset. Customers browse through reviews when they're researching products and so on. And we are using machine learning for a number of different things in reviews. First of all, ranking reviews. Many products receive thousands of reviews, customers cannot sift through all of them. We are also using machine learning techniques to detect fake reviews, right? Which is, reviews that were written by sellers to promote their own products, or sometimes written by sellers to bring down the products that their competitors are selling. We're also applying machine learning techniques to many problems in the text domain. So, for instance, recognizing named entities. Dan talked about named entity recognition. So, we have Kindle books, we have a lot of digital content, and recognizing named entities in all our digital content and then linking those references to maybe Wikipedia, IMDb, which is a site that Amazon also owns, or Amazon detail pages. So if you see some product references in any of our pages, you want to kind of link all the content together. Summarization is another area which is very important. We want to summarize product descriptions, product reviews, so that they can fit in these small form factors of mobile devices and smartphones. On the image side, you know, we have apps that will allow you to allow users to point their smartphones towards a product and then retrieve visually similar images from our catalog and visually similar products from our catalog. I'm sure many of the folks here use AWS. MechTurk is an extremely popular crowdsourcing platform, and you know, that enables users to get a number of tasks such as document or image labeling done very cost effectively. Here again, we're using machine learning to compute reputation scores for MechTurk workers and then schedule tasks to workers based on their reputations. And finally, you know, I showed you a demo of sort of a video of Alexa. So within Alexa, a lot of stuff is being powered by, you know, very scalable implementations of deep learning algorithms, and these are being used for voice recognition. So all the voice recognition in Alexa is actually powered by, you know, state-of-the-art implementations, very parallel implementations of deep learning methods. There's also understanding of customer intent, and we're now moving into, you know, agents that can carry out conversations with users. So there's a lot of stuff that's happening in terms of machine learning within Amazon, and clearly a lot of this is also applicable to the general e-commerce domain. So many of the companies out there in the e-commerce domain are working on very similar problems. So let me dive a little bit deeper into a few select problems. You know, an important problem for us is product demand forecasting. They say in the airline business, whichever airline can, you know, reliably predict the future price of oil is most likely to be successful. And, you know, something similar holds for the retail business. Whatever company can predict future product demand is very likely to succeed. And so that's where really technology comes in place. And we, you know, we are talking about product demand forecasts that may be even 52 weeks ahead. So you're trying to, you know, for certain products, we're even trying to predict a year or two out what the demand for the product will be, right? And that's something, you know, that's where you need things like machine learning and so on. So what are the challenges, right? I already mentioned, you know, there's a time frame. You're trying to predict really way out in the future. But of course, you know, within Amazon, scale is a big theme. Everything we do really involves massive scale. You know, we have hundreds of millions of products. I talked about a catalog with over a billion products. We have hundreds of millions of users. So all the algorithms we develop have to scale to that level. Another common theme you're going to find, and this is not just with Amazon, this is with most of the large internet companies, is the cold start problem. You know, this involves new products that don't have historical data, right? There's no past demand. Typically, you make predictions about future demand based on the past historical demand for those products, right? And without past demand, it becomes a challenge. How are you going to predict future demand? Data sparsity is another big theme that you know, kind of spans all our applications. There's a huge queue in the data. Most of the products, you know, there are very few products that actually sell a lot. And then you have a long tail. Okay, so this is the long tail phenomenon where you have, you know, millions and millions of products that have extremely small number of purchases, right? But we still want to catch, you know, one of Amazon's tenets is really, we want to offer the, you know, broadest selection of products to our customers, right? So even if there is there are three customers who are interested in a product, we want to you know, carry it in our online catalog. And that's one of the things that actually differentiates online commerce from offline commerce. In online e-commerce companies can really provide their customers with infinite selection, right? One of the consequences of this infinite selection is that you're going to end up with a long tail of products that really, you know, don't sell as much, maybe a demand of one or two. And again, you're trying to predict those extremely sparse and rare events that that happen. Of course, you know, demands for products has seasonal patterns. You know, swimsuits sell in summers. You know, your sweaters sell in winters, right? So your models have to be able to incorporate these seasonal patterns for products. There are demand spikes, so you have specific events like Mother's Day or Diwali in India, where you know there's a sudden demand spike, or there may be unexpected events like a sudden snowstorm, right? And that leads to a huge spike in demand for snow shovels, maybe. And the final point, I think, is very important. A lot of people who use machine learning, you know, use models that will give them a point estimate. And typically, these regression models that people use in their applications will give you like the average demand. But for applications like product demand forecasting, what we are interested in is really the 90th percentile of demand. What we want is the complete probability distribution of demand. And this is because our ordering systems, right, place orders for products based on these forecasts. And, you know, we are a very customer-centric and customer-obsessed company. So we don't want our customers to see out-of-stock messages, right? So ordering based on the average demand would, you know, or 50 percentile of demand would mean there's a 50% chance that our customers see the product to be out-of-stock. So that's not acceptable to us. So what we want is really the 90th percentile of demand. And that's where we, you know, place orders. So there's a 90% chance that when a customer comes to Amazon, they're going to see the product be in stock, right? And that's the 90 percentile of demand is what our ordering systems use for ordering ordering products out there. So moving on to, and this is an important point. I know many, you know, folks have talked about really error bars and confidence intervals and so on. So if there's one, you know, message again to take away here, it is really, I mean, you know, a lot of people focus on just the prediction or the average values, but the confidence interval or the uncertainty of that prediction is equally important, and applications should take into account how confident is the model about the prediction that is made. Okay. Now, again, product recommendations, clearly this is something that we've been doing for a while. If you look at you know, this is the customers who bought this also bought a widget on our, on the Amazon product detail pages. And so some of the challenges, again, in recommendations are similar to what we saw for predicting product demand. You know, there's a scale problem, except this time you have both users and products. When you talk about recommendations, this is dyadic data. Of course, a lot of the product demand forecasting happens offline, so the models are trained offline. But in recommendations, really, this is a real-time scenario, right? The customer is right on your product detail page, and you have to, you know, dynamically generate recommendations for the customer, taking into account the context, you know, the product that the customer may have just recently browsed or is currently browsing. So all this needs, computation needs to happen in less than, you know, in a few tens of milliseconds or maybe even sub 10 milliseconds. You know, the customers who bought this also bought widget is not really personalized, right? What it shows you are products that were frequently co-purchased with the product that you're currently viewing, right? So what we want here is really to personalize this. We want to learn about user preferences based on past products that they have purchased, maybe past products that they have browsed, and based on that, you know, get a sense of what the interests of the users are, what the preferences of the users are, and then use that to make product recommendations. Of course, recommendations also take into account the context. As I mentioned earlier, you know, the context can be the product you're currently browsing, maybe the product that you just browsed, So that provides context. Of course, with mobiles and smartphones, your location also becomes part of the context. May choose to do different recommendations based on, you know, whether you're at home or you're in a mall and so on. The problem of data sparsity also applies here because, again, there's a long tail of users, right? A small number of users typically are, you know, big customers who buy a lot, but there's a huge number of customers we have who make small number of purchases, and we have to, you know, do recommendations from them also. Another interesting problem that we have is that of multiple user personas. A user account may be shared by multiple users, right? At home, my wife does all the buying, right? We have a single account. She buys for the kids, she buys for herself, she buys for me. So we've got to be able to separate that out, you know, who are the people in the household. So this all becomes latent variables, so you need fairly sophisticated models to break down the purchases and separate them out. Well, this was done for one persona, and this was done for the kids, and this was done for a male who's between 40 and 50 years old, and so on. And of course, there's a cold start problem again. You know, there are new products and users constantly coming in, and we need to make recommendations for them. Clearly, product search is an important area for us. Drives a lot of traffic to Amazon, and as I mentioned, you know, we have over 50% of market share for just product search, that category, right? And we use machine learning for ranking search results and so on. Here again, you have this, similar challenges of scale, new products coming in, they have to surface as part of your search results. Real-time prediction, you've got to compute your search results page in real time when a user enters a search query. But there are two other interesting challenges here. One is around natural language, right? So you want to really understand the semantics of the query, right? You want to segment the queries, you want to identify the different phrases in the query, you want to even understand what those different phrases mean, what the semantics of the different phrases is, and that kind of relates to what Dan Roth was talking in the morning. Another important thing is you need to detect the customer intent, right? Is the customer looking to buy purchase a product, or the customer is just researching the product? And you may show very different search results depending on one or the other, right? If a customer is looking to purchase the product, you may show the same product sold by different sellers and at different prices. But if the customer is researching the product, you may show the product sold by different brands, for instance, or different versions of the product and so on, different variants of the product. You also want to classify the query into a product category, right? And then show products from that category. And I'll give you this example here. Suppose the user types in a query, red Apple iPhone, right? Here, you want your search engine to understand that Apple here is a brand, right? And this query is really looking for products in the smartphone category, right? And so the search results should be all smartphones. However, the query was red apples, right? Then it's a totally different meaning. Then the query really belongs to the grocery category, and what you want to show in your search results are produce items, right, as opposed to smartphones. So again, just dropping a word completely changes the semantics of the query. And so the query engine needs to understand the semantics so that they can show you the relevant products. We are also building a knowledge graph on products. This knowledge graph contains a wide amount of information about products like title, price, brand information, color, and so on. And we're looking at using some of that information from the knowledge graph to populate structured abstracts on search result pages. The knowledge graph also stores relationships between products. I talked about substitutes. There are many other product relationships. There could be accessories, there could be complements, you could have sequels, variants, so on, right? So the knowledge graph will capture all those relationships. And the idea then, again, is to show related products in response to search queries. I talked about a giant taxonomy, product taxonomy that we have with over 20,000 leaf nodes that customers sort of browse through to discover products. And for classifying products in that taxonomy, we actually use the product titles. We use some of the fields like descriptions and so on, even the product images. Here, clearly, again, scale is a huge problem. I haven't seen classification problems with 20,000 classes, right? So that's a huge challenge in itself. And of course, you know, many of these classes are very hard to distinguish between. So for instance, it's difficult to distinguish between, you know, a laptop product and then you just add battery, right? So that becomes a totally different product. It's an accessory. So it's just one word that's separating the product from the accessory. So some of these classes can be difficult to separate out, right? Especially when you're looking to classify into 20,000 classes. And, you know, like I said, one of the features we use, which has a lot of signal, are the product titles, right? And these are short, there are a small number of keywords that we are trying to use to classify the product. And the real world is not great, right? The training data is typically very poor quality. So we have lots of products that are really wrongly labeled, so they're put in the wrong category. You know, sometimes errors can be as high as 30%. So you have a situation where you have noise, a lot of noise in the data. And of course, there's huge class imbalance problems, right? There are many classes with very small number of examples. So for instance, some classes may have a million examples, while there are some other classes that may have just, you know, maybe 10 examples. Another problem that's really hugely important for us is product matching. Now, when many sellers sell the same product, you end up with duplicates in the catalog. And you can see these products are all actually duplicates, but you can see the titles, they were quite different, the images are different, but they were just listed by different sellers, right? So, you know, these duplicates don't really lead to a great customer experience. If you typed in a search queries and three of these showed up in your search results, you're not going to be a very happy customer, right, with seeing duplicate products as part of your search results. So identifying these duplicates is extremely important. And this is a challenging problem. One thing that we need in our application is very high precision. So when we say a pair of products are duplicates, they better be duplicates. Actually, there are applications that require 100% precision. So for instance, a lot of our pricing happens based on really prices for many of the products that are sold, you know, the same product sold by different sellers, right? Now, if we took an accessory and showed it as a duplicate of a normal product, you are going to have a situation where the price suddenly, you know, looks very low because you may pay a price based on the lowest price of all the duplicates, right? So the precision needs to be very high. The consequence of making an error here can be huge in terms of price. And of course, you know, the notion of duplicates itself is very subjective, right? For certain categories, color is very important. Like for instance, apparel, right? A blue color shirt and a red color shirt are different products. You know, they are not duplicates because people really have strong color preferences. But you know, for a washing machine, does the color really matter, right? So again, the notion of duplicates itself is quite subjective, and that makes the problem challenging. And of course, like I said earlier, the formats can be very different. Like we saw, the titles were represented very differently in the different products and so on. So the final application that I want to just dive deep into is this one on information extraction from reviews. As I mentioned, you know, clearly reviews are extremely important. They help build trust with our customers. You know, all of us browse through reviews. You know, on TripAdvisor when we're booking hotels or planning trips, on Amazon when you're looking to buy products. So it's very important that we get rid of fake reviews. Also, you know, some products have thousands of reviews. Customers can browse all of that. So, you know, we need to have a way of maybe surfacing, you know, the prominent trends in the reviews. So here, some of the frequent snippets have been surfaced. We also collect ratings from our users on the products, so those get aggregated and they're shown here. But this is at a very coarse granularity, so this is at the granularity of the product. Well, how do you rate the product? But in many cases, users may want to know, well, how good is the battery life on this product? Or how good is the camera on the phone, right? So you want fine-grained ratings. And one of the projects we have is really around extracting fine-grained product ratings from reviews, right? And this, again, has a whole host of challenges. Clearly, you know, different categories have different product attributes that are important. For a cell phone, you know, the battery life, the camera quality, the pixel density, those may be important features, important aspects. But for a washing machine, what may be more important is the capacity, whether it's front loading or top loading, and those sorts of features, right? Now, the question is, if you want to really scale this to large number of categories, you want to automate discovery of these product attributes for the different categories. And here, the challenges could be around different synonyms. You know, you have many different terms that refer to the same product attribute. So that makes it difficult to discover these attributes automatically. And then, of course, there is the whole problem of sentiment analysis. So if you want to really automatically determine what the rating is for a certain product attribute, you need to do sentiment analysis. This requires natural language understanding techniques, also deep parsing of sentences, and so on. Okay. So let me just quickly get on to my last two topics, which is some of the pain points with ML platforms and tools. These are the things we use to develop applications. So clearly, here's the sequence of steps that you typically follow when you build a model. And I'll just quickly go through this. You start with your business problem. You map it to a prediction problem with model performance, evaluation and metrics, and so on. Collect data. You have to clean the data. You know, there are missing values. There's outliers. You visualize the data to try and figure out which attributes have predictive power, which are the attributes that are highly correlated with the target. And then you do some feature transformations. Maybe bin your numeric values, you create n-grams of your text attributes and so on, and then you train your models, right? And that involves hyperparameter tuning, right? You want to get the best set of parameters that will give you the best model for yourself. And then if after you evaluate your model performance, maybe looking at the AUC or the accuracy or the error measures and so on, if your model meets your business goals, you go ahead and deploy the model in production. Otherwise, you go back and you try and get more data, do more feature engineering. Now, this is currently quite manual. You know, many of these steps are, involve considerable amount of manual effort. And for some of the steps, like visualization, we have tools like, you know, matplotlib, or for model training, you have tools like XGBoost, WowPalRabbit, and so on. But integrating all these diverse tools together in a workflow is, again, extremely cumbersome. And that's where a lot of time is getting spent. I think 80% of time that scientists spend is really trying to string together all these diverse tools, integrate them into a workflow when you're trying to deploy your solutions in production, right? So, you know, one way to address, there are many things that we need to do to address these pain points. First, you need automated tools for many of these steps, right? Data cleaning, right? I mean, you need tools that can, you know, impute your missing values, maybe find outliers in the data, get rid of them. Of course, there's a lot of talk about deep learning, generating all these high-level features and embeddings that we can use in our models to get better performance. So you need tools to generate these high-level features, right? So that a lot of the feature engineering can be automated. A lot of scientists spend a lot of time in feature engineering. And then, you know, there is also the problem of just, you know, which algorithm do you select? There's, you know, linear models, there are random forests, there's gradient-boosted trees like XGBoost, there's neural networks. So, you know, I mean, typically scientists go try out everything. And, you know, some models have non-linearity, some models don't scale. So there's, every one of them is strong in some space you're looking at. And also, if you look at neural networks, they have a ton of different parameters that need to be tuned. The number of layers, the number of hidden units, learning rate, regularization, and so on. So how do we automate all this, right? I mean, there is some initial, lot of work that's been going on using Gaussian processes, neural networks themselves, based models for trying and tuning hyperparameters and so on. Also integrating these different machine learning tools. So one approach that we are taking at Amazon is to take a lot of these tools, package them in Docker containers, and then implement Spark ML estimator and transformer APIs on top so that they can be integrated into Spark ML pipelines. And of course, you know, I feel like the machine learning field is where the database field was 20, 30 years ago. You know, today, when you use a database system, you type in a very high-level SQL query, and, you know, the database engine goes in and crunches things, gets your execution plan, executes it, and so on, right? So it's very easy for the user. Everything is automated. So what, you know, the long-term vision, I think that's where machine learning is going to go is really, you know, building these models is going to become very easy. Users will specify their problem at a very high level using some sort of specification, and all these machine learning workflows that, you know, do the work, heavy lifting below, will be automatically generated. So let me conclude with some of the big AI challenges. These have been covered by the previous speakers, so I'll go through quick. I think I've pretty much run out of time. Can I have 5 minutes? Yeah, okay. So, you know, a lot of these things have been talked about already, so there's no surprise. So maybe some are a little bit different and more specific to Amazon. But, so, you know, clearly question answering is a big area and clearly a big AI challenge still, you know. In Alexa, you know, you saw that many of the users were asking all sorts of questions. Within my team, we're working on really shopping-related questions and answering them using product descriptions and product reviews. That's the content we have. So, you know, some example questions, a simple question is something like this, which is, you know, what's the pixel density on this phone? It has a factoid answer. It's a factual answer, so it's fairly straightforward. Of course, now you can make this a little bit more complex and ask a question, will this suitcase fit in the overhead of an airplane? Now, there are many ways of answering this question, right? And I'm not sure what's the right approach. One is, well, in the review, maybe somebody just says, yeah, this suitcase fits in the overhead of an airplane. And yeah, so you just match that up and you say, yes, it will fit. And you know, show that review snippet, right? The other way to do it is really you figure out, you know, somewhere on Wikipedia or on the web, you know what the size of the overhead of an airplane is, and you know what the size of the suitcase is, size in terms of volume and length, breadth, height, and all that, and your algorithm is smart enough that it can figure out that this is smaller than the overhead of an airplane, right? Now that, I think, is quite a challenging, you know, doing it that way is quite challenging. So, but, you know, there may be easier ways of answering the question. Maybe there's somebody who's just said that in a review, and all you have to do is match, do some, you know, a neural network and just pick up that pattern and answer the question. So, again, if you have lots and lots of data, then maybe that, you know, latter approach works. And then there are comparison questions, right? I mean, which of these TVs from LG or Samsung has a better picture quality, right? So this is, and then of course you can go one step further and then have agents that actually carry on multi-turn conversations with users, right? So here you have a user who says she's going on a vacation to Goa, and then you have the agent that talks about all sorts of amazing adventure sports in Goa, recommends some places for doing scuba diving and so on, and then also talks about some great deals on scuba gear products that are available on Amazon, right? So, you know, being able to really go through an entire conversation. So here again, the challenge is at any point in the conversation, you need to have capture very succinctly the context so far of the conversation, right? And of course, embeddings in deep neural networks can capture those contexts. So they maybe, again, deep neural networks are a great technology for conversational systems because they can really succinctly represent context of the conversation so far. Let's see, okay. I love this problem of text summarization. I think it's got huge number of applications. If we can do that multi-document text summarization really well, you know, within Amazon, you know, there are lots of applications. We could, you know, summarize reviews. We could, you know, summarize Kindle books and present, you know, shorter versions of you know, 500-page books. Maybe extract, or also extract product attribute ratings, you know, fine-grained product attributes ratings from reviews. So here, you know, this is from DP Review. So these are all manually generated. So there's a summary of the product generated by humans, and then, you know, they've rated the camera on many different dimensions. So you can see here, image quality is one dimension. There's performance and so on. So, you know, be great if we can do all this automatically. This is all done by humans, by experts. You know, DP Review is a great site for cameras and so on. But automating all this would be great. Of course, you know, it'd be great if we could, you know, if you had text summarization, you could probably automatically generate Wikipedia pages on any topic, right? So you just type in, you know, your query, and then maybe you, you know, a search engine gets 100 pages on that are relevant to that query, and then, you know, you put it into your text summarization engine, and it generates a Wikipedia page on the topic. Right now at Amazon, we actually hire a lot of editors to generate content, right? So, and a lot of the, you know, there's expert review sites. A lot of our reviews are given by users. We don't know how good the quality is, but if we could generate high quality reviews of products, that would be great. Now, there's a lot of progress that's been made using deep learning methods for generating captions for images. And I've seen some work that does a pretty good job identifying, you know, putting in a description or a caption for what's in an image. But, you know, this is a new challenge. Can you automatically generate a description or a review for a video, right? So identify all the actors who are in the video, the plot of the movie. You know, all this can be metadata that you use to surface relevant videos as in response to a video search query. There are a lot of machine learning applications in robotics. Within Amazon, we acquired a company, I think 5-6 years ago, called Kiva. And these, you know, these are the Kiva robots. So, you know, our warehouses are huge. They're like 6 football fields and extremely large warehouses. So the distance between where the products are stored on the shelves and where the products get packaged is really large. And for humans to walk up and down is extremely laborious, time-consuming, tedious, and so on. So these Kiva robots, these orange things that you see, they transport products from shelves to the areas where the products get packaged. Of course, we still have humans who do the picking of the product from the shelf and storing them in these yellow containers that are then transported by the Kiva robots. So, you know, robots aren't as good. Still, we don't have technology that will allow robots to pick products. And, you know, we are talking about a lot of different products. It could be apples, it could be fruits, it could be CDs, and so on. So that's one big project that's ongoing within Amazon right now, which is how do you get, you know, automated picking and stowing, which is putting it back, putting in these yellow containers. Of course, we have our Prime Air, which is our drone program that looks to deliver packages in less than 30 minutes using drones. And I'll show a quick video. I don't know if you have time for that. This uses, again, you know, computer vision, machine learning. You try to recognize objects and so on. And then you have your self-driving cars that many of the companies are working on. They use deep reinforcement learning to sort of optimize long-term rewards and so on. I think I'll just skip this video in interest of time. I mean, there's a proliferation of devices and sensors and so on. You have fitness devices that generate streams of heart rate, blood pressure. You have sensors at homes that are generating streams of temperature, CO2. I mean, I think the future, you're going to see a lot of these data streams being analyzed to kind of try and find anomalies. For instance, you could say if somebody is having a heart attack just based on these measurements, or know if a house is on fire or if there's a break-in in a house. You know, there's video surveillance cameras being installed in homes, and they are generating video streams and so on. So there's a lot of stuff that still needs to be done in terms of online machine learning algorithms. You know, some of these machine learning data structures are very difficult to build on data streams. Of course, linear models are probably, you know, you can build those on linear streams, but building a decision tree or a random forest on streams of data is quite challenging. Again, you know, deep learning is being used. So promising technology for many of these problems and these AI challenges is deep learning. You know, we've got to see how far we can go. I mean, you saw some of the questions that people may have. I'm not sure deep learning is equipped to handle all those questions. It all depends on how much data you have, right? So I give you an example of where maybe certain questions can be answered very easily if somebody has already answered that question, right? And what deep learning does, and I think Dan Roth also talked about this, is really it learns higher level features at every layer. So here you have a DNN that's really trained on images of faces. You can see, you know, the first layer you have edges, edge features in different orientations. These get combined in the next layer to, you know, for parts of faces like lips, noses, eyes, and so on. And then at the highest layer, you have, you know, face shapes of different persons. So with that, I'm just going to conclude. Lots of applications of machine learning at Amazon and in e-commerce in general. Clearly, there's a lot of work that needs to be done on the platform and tools front. And of course, you know, there's a whole host of really big AI challenges that people still need to solve. So, you know, all of us are going to have work and be employed for at least a decade, I think, because none of these are simple problems. Yeah. Okay. Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Rajeev.